person testing this, can you hear me?
Yes.
And if anybody needs an assistive listening device, we do have them out front, and I encourage you to use them. Of course, if you have trouble hearing, and I made that announcement, you may not have heard me. I realized that yesterday. Are there any announcements for the life of this church or community? Meg?
We have had wonderful response to people being greeters and readers and so forth this month. But we have next Sunday, the last Sunday of the month, we have all of January, just waiting for people to fill in their names, to be greeters, readers, and to put out our copy out. So please sign up for fellowship following the church.
Okay, so there is a sign up available back in the parish house to sign up as a reader, or to provide yummy food and drinks. And we would love to have your help. We've done it through December, but now it's New Year and we need some fresh energy. Other announcements, Bob?
We had our December council meeting on Wednesday night and reviewed the financials for 2019. We want to thank all of you for your contributions and help. We came out of the year with nearly a balanced budget, so that's good. As for planning for 2020, we are ahead in our pledges, but we still need additional pledges for this year so that we can plan for the year, because given the pledges that we've got to date, we're still at a slight deficit budget. So if you want to, if you're planning to give this year and planning to pledge, please do that within the next couple weeks.
And by this year, you mean 2020?
Yes.
Okay, so planning to give next year, but feel free to tell us this year. Any, Wendy?
Can I just, I received a message from Hojan, our previous minister.
Yes.
With the greeting.
Yes, please.
So he said, I have been doing, so this is from Hojan, our previous minister. And I have been doing very well, preaching, writing, exercising, walking, getting physical therapy, traveling. God is great, life is good. All good and bad are to be seen in God's grace. I plan to travel to Taiwan early in January and return in mid-March or even much later in 2020. I do hope that you are all well, including my many church friends. Wishing you all a Merry Christmas and a happy and healthy New Year. Please keep in touch, Hojan.
Thank you, Wendy. If you want to make a copy of that for Joanne, we could put it in the January newsletter. That would be nice to share with everybody. Any other announcements? Well, quick reminder, in case anybody didn't notice, there's a day coming up in a couple days, Christmas. So we are busy on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, and you are more than welcome to come to one of our ways of observing and celebrating. We have 5 o'clock and 10 o'clock Christmas Eve services that will include carols, all kinds of special music, as well as our familiar, we all get to sing the carol, at least the first verse. We're going for the verses that we all know pretty well, and candle lighting. It's each of those services is a beautiful service, a beautiful reflection on what this day truly means to us. And then on Christmas morning, for those that want to be in church, we encourage you to come in your pajamas, and we usually tell a children's story that has the meaning of Christmas built into it, and it's usually interactive, so everybody gets a bell, and you hear a certain word, you ring your bell, so it's fun, it's lighthearted. Sue is going to play, right, you're planning to play some carols for us. She's going to give us a playlist, and we can choose from the ones that she knows well. And that's more than we've had. Christmas morning is usually spontaneous, so some years we have music and some years we don't. One year we had our pianist played all Charlie Brown, and the kids were dancing in the aisles to Charlie Brown. That may be my favorite Christmas morning experience ever. Other announcements for the life of the church. then please, there are people here who don't know each other yet, so I encourage you to stand up, say hello, greet each other, introduce yourself, and welcome somebody that you don't know, make a new friend.
Yeah.
meditating on a song. What an amazing way to begin today's service. Today we will be meditating on the song of love, as sung by the angels to the shepherds, but we will think also about how those angels triggered every single song that we focus on during Advent this season. Please join me and the White family as we light the candle of love this morning. As you are able, and join us for Psalm 135, Angels We Have Heard on High. Cannot say out loud. And we close with the Lord's Prayer. which we have already heard once this morning sung by Alyssa. Are there prayers of concern or celebration that you wish to share out loud today? Yes, Meg.
I'd like us to have in our prayers all the people who are mourning recent losses. We had a wonderful celebration for Mary Howe yesterday, but there are many other folks who have lost people. This is a particularly difficult time. Flossie Blake, my mother's roommate at Mineral Springs, passed away at 109. And John Colnett, one of Fletcher and Conley, and his daughter Courtney, who lived her whole life being severely disabled when she passed away this week. And I just found out one of my college roommate's son, who was a physician at 36 years old, died from brain tumor.
Oh, my
goodness. Devastating. Anyway, sometimes more recent losses are even harder to get.
So prayers for those that have experienced a loss. Sometimes the most recent ones are the most difficult, but the landscape of holidays can be particularly challenging when you have experienced losses, the ending of a relationship, the death of someone, changes. We think of Mary Howe's family, Courtney Colback family, Flossie Hazen's family, and the family of Meg's friend, who's 36-year-old son, and so many others. Any prayers? We'll hear a little bit more about this later, but Jean Nimmer was at our 8 o'clock gathering this morning, and she was talking about the new work that she's doing at the Adult Day Center, where she dances with the Alzheimer's patients. And so that is an amazing experience, and I will share a little bit more about what that looks like to her. But for those who are doing this dance with people whose cognition is changing, for those who live inside of those bodies where their brain takes away part of their ability to connect with others, for the dignity of life as our bodies and our minds change, and for those who love us through everything, and for the caregivers that are tender and resilient in the face of all that we live with these changes. Are there other prayers? Yes,
Tom. Well, I'd like to say a prayer for Congresswoman Engel, who lost her husband earlier this year. I'm sure he's in heaven looking down at all of us and wishing all Christians love in this special holiday season.
So, prayer for the Congresswoman who lost her husband. Prayers of gratitude for Sasha's well-being and for all those who love Sasha. There was also a prayer request this morning at 8 o'clock for all those who are traveling during the holidays. For safe departures, arrivals, and if you get stuck somewhere along the way, may you find the help you need to get you through to the next place along the journey. Let us be in prayer. O Holy God, you come to us today as a song of love. And love has so many different shapes and expressions. Each of us has a different way of showing our love and receiving love. But in all those forms, you are present. And we ask that you help us open ourselves to the presence of love. When it is hardest for us to receive love, may we have the courage to say yes when it is offered to us. And sometimes when it is hardest to offer it, may we find a way to connect and be present. We ask that you will hear our prayers for those who have experienced loss and grief of all kinds in this season, for those who need healing or simply dignity and comfort along the way, for for our children who are being launched in new directions, for all those who travel, for those living with altered cognition, for our civil and civic leaders, for those who put themselves in harm's way, our children all over the world, for taking up the call to be present as an act of love in so many different creative and courageous ways. May you hear our prayers, and may you listen now to our silence. Please hear us as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thou hast the kingdom, the power, and glory forever.
Scripture today is from Luke 2, verses 1 through 20. The birth of Jesus. In those days, a decree went out from the Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was the governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah and the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in the band's cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace among those favors. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us. So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. And but Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them.
So first I actually want to invite you and children to come help me, because we are thinking a little bit about the nativity story today and the pieces and parts of it. So when you guys walked in the front door, if you walked in the front door, what did you see? Yeah, we saw the nativity scene, the crash. Did anybody notice what was missing? No baby Jesus. Did anybody notice that there were some other figures that you traditionally see that weren't right around the stable? The wise ones. They're all over here in the corner, journeying on their own. So we're going to bring them a little bit further on their journey today. So could I get you guys and you ladies to help me? We're just going to go. We're not going to bring all of them because there's so many. There's so many. We're going to go this way. And we're going to get some wise ones. And they're camels. And we're going to pass them out so everybody else to put on the windowsills closest to them. So anything that's wooden, I would suggest taking. We can take like a handful of wooden ones. There's plenty of wooden ones. Probably just enough for four people to carry some. Yeah, camels too. And we're going to pass them out to people sitting close to the windowsills and have them place them so that these folks keep going on their journey. Do you want to grab some? Yeah, that would be good. Okay, I see a couple more camels. Those can go. Can you guys get those? No, just the camels in the guys. Okay, so if you two will go to this side, that way, and you guys go to that side. Yep, just pass it out to people sitting close to the windows. So if you're sitting close to the window, we have a present for you. And we would like you to put it somewhere that you can safely balance it. We're only bringing in the wooden ones, so the more breakable ones we're not going to move around today. And the idea behind these figures moving is that, you know, we put the nativity story together. Everybody's like all at the same scene at the same time. But truthfully, oh, I see somebody gesturing back there. There's a naked window sill. We can't. If we don't have enough, we'll bring out. We have plenty more wise ones. Do we need more wise ones, or do we have just enough? Are we good? Okay. So the wise ones probably took at least a year to show up at the nativity scene. We're going to squash that down into just a couple weeks, and we'll tell that story in a week or two. But that's part of what Epiphany celebrates. So the 12 days of Christmas is that time between the birth of Christ and Epiphany. And that's when we tell the stories of the wise ones coming to bear their gifts to Christ and also his early childhood stories. So right now, he hasn't even been born yet. So the wise ones are journeying, and in a couple weeks we'll tell stories of his childhood and his young adulthood. You may have seen, too, that there's a sign there that says Jesus was a refugee, and that will not have to do with his arrival in the city of David, where his parents go for the census, because in fact he was actually welcomed into a family home. You know how it says there was no room for him in the inn? That's something that we say, but it's not actually in the Bible. The word that is, there's a word for guest room, and he would have been welcomed into a family home because his ancestors and his relatives lived there. So he wasn't kicked out to a barn. He was probably welcomed into a lower room in a family house where they brought their animals in at night because the animals lived with the families in these houses. And during the day, they cleaned it out and used it for human habitation. But because there were so few people, there were so many people, the guest room was already being used, so they put the family in the animal room. So he was actually welcomed into a family home that night, but later when Herod was talking to the wise ones, right, Herod planned to kill him. And Herod is known as having been quite a bloodthirsty leader. He killed his own sons. That's a historic fact. So it's quite likely that he would have seen the report of somebody else as a threat. And the Holy Family is reported to have left and gone to Egypt. and hidden there until Herod died. So the refugee part of the claim of Christ's life is early in his life. We'll talk about that later. It's not today, and it's not right in this story. But it is a piece of why we see this family as showing us so many different human experiences. I ask you to pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Today we are focusing on an earlier part of the story, and that is the song of love that was sung by the angels to the Holy Family and then to the shepherds. Angels show up and talk to Mary. The Ave Maria is a rephrasing of that song that Mary sings in response. The angels show up and silence Zechariah. Remember, we talked about silence, because Zechariah, who was performing his work in the temple, met an angel back there, and when he came out to talk to the crowd to perform his office, he had no voice. He had questioned the angel that told him that his son John would be born and would prepare the way for the coming of love and the Messiah. And so he was silenced until his child was born 9 months later. But his wife Elizabeth sang songs with Mary, songs of justice and vision for a tangible heaven on earth, a place where there was justice for all people, not sometime in the future, but now. And that is the language of Luke that we hear again today. Luke frequently places us not far away, but in a very specific context and in the here and the now. And today, when the angels come, it's not just one, it's a whole host of angels, and they are singing to the shepherds. Now, if you were going to announce the birth of somebody who is supposed to change the world, again, you might think that they would go sing to the kings and the judges that would rise up, and the generals that would rise up, and the military leaders, the resistance fighters that wanted to change the course of Roman history that was being imposed upon them. But that song was sung to shepherds in the field very nearby, to the common people that were close to where the family was staying. It was sung to the everyday person first. And the first lines of the song say, "Do not be afraid. This is good news." And it isn't good news for Herod, and it isn't good news for Caesar Augustus. It's good news for everybody. It's good news for you in the field. It's good news for the midwife that helped Mary have that baby. It's good news for the person that has to collect the information for the census. It's good news for the person that's bringing the fodder to the animals that all the families are keeping in their homes. It's good news for everyone. This good news isn't located just inside the household of Joseph and Mary. It goes out into the world, and it doesn't stop inside the walls of this church, and it doesn't stop inside our labels about who belongs and who doesn't. It keeps going, and it goes further and further, and it opens doors, and it knocks down walls. And if we think that love, I say it every time, is some kind of concept, we're missing the point. Love is a song, and love is a muscle. Today, when we talked about love at the 8 o'clock service, we asked ourselves, what does love look like when it becomes a song? And there was literally a story told about a mother and a daughter. The mother had a stroke. And her power of speech was taken away, so much like Zechariah. And her daughter was trying so hard to communicate with her, but they couldn't speak. She was nonverbal, and it gets to be very hard. And I worked in an ICU, an intensive care unit, as a hospice chaplain and a medical chaplain. And the most challenging person to speak to is somebody who's awake, but has been intubated and is on a ventilator, so they can't pass any air through their vocal cords, they can't talk to you, and there's a whole lot of emotion and a whole lot of thinking going on there, and no way to communicate it. And if you're lucky, you get a picture. chart, and it has a picture of things like water, heat, like on coal. You can talk about basic necessities, but you can't get to talking about your emotions or abstract concepts when you're pointing at a chart like this. You might be able to talk about facial expressions, sad or happy, but so much of the way that we communicate disappears. So here's a woman that had a stroke and she lost her voice, but her daughter discovered that the part of the brain that accesses music was unaffected, and so they started singing to each other. She couldn't speak, but she could sing. It was a different part of the brain. Sometimes the language of love literally shows up as a song. They could sing to each other. The power of song comes out of our tradition. It was seized on by the people that spoke to angels and echoed down to us. And it continues to be a power in our lives. Sometimes when it's hard to unify, music is the one thing that pulls us together. There's a priest out on the West Coast who's working with children that he's bringing in off the streets. This was on Krista Tippett this morning. And one of the mantras that he says to himself when he's walking around is this. Here, now. And he doesn't mean here, he means here, H-E-R-E, this place, right here, right now. Being present to nothing more than this moment. We talked this morning about the fact that sometimes we're so busy trying to love somebody that we try to fix everything. We offer every key that we have, trying to unlock the door to connect with somebody and fix it, make it just right. And guess what I learned when I was in conflict with my teenage daughter, because we butted heads all the time, right? If I said black, she said white, or saw white. Until I learned that the best way to talk to somebody that you might be on opposite sides with was to say, what can I do to help you? How can I support you? If you stop trying to use all the keys you have, and you do what this priest does, this, here, now, and you simply ask the question, how can I help you? How can I support you? The person that you're talking to, instead of screaming at you, is likely to give you the key that you need to unlock the door for the barrier between you, and enter into their lives and be present in a way that is loving and most helpful to them. And Tish, who was there at the 8 o'clock, said, but what if you invert that phrase and you say, now hear this? It's a whole different phrase, isn't it? Instead of being present and opening the door, now hear this, is directive, and it tells you what to do, and it's like trying to take a key and fit it into a lock where it may not go. But this, here, now. The song of the angels and the language of Luke, which is for all people, and that says that peace will come, but only when you open yourself to what peace requires of you, is this, here, now. It is being present to this place and this time, to the heaven that we can bring into our world and the love that we can keep in our own time and place. The song of love can be sung. For others, it may be food. We know soup is one of Sue's great ways of loving people and cooking for people. Each one of us has a different way of loving each other. And sometimes you need a different key. But often, if you simply ask, how can I love you? The person that you are reaching toward has the answer that you need. And it may not be that you can fix what's happening. It may simply be that you are present, that you showed up, and you cared enough to ask in the first place. The song of love, it is yours, but it's often the art of listening so that someone else can tell you how to sing it. Thanks be to God. Please rise for the song, The First Noel, on page 141. We'll just do verses 1, 3, and 5.
Thank you.
alive in the world, and we have expressed our love with these offerings. May we open ourselves to love, and may what we have offered, both in our lives and here in this place, go out into the places that it is needed to help those who need to feel the presence of love again in their lives. Amen. And we can stay standing and we'll sing It Came Upon Me Right Here, Psalm 149 in the red candle, followed by our benediction, which is printed here in the bulletin. And then there's lots of yummy cookies and very good snacks made by our hospitality team. The language of love and food. Oh, how many verses? First grade.
Thank you.